There are some things I do now I'm in my 50s that I never thought I would do. When I was younger, if I'd thought about these things, I would never have imagined myself doing them. So in this video, which isn't going to be very long, I just thought I'd share these five things with you. And let me know in the comments, what do you do in your 50s or your 60s that feel perfectly normal to you now, but you could never have imagined doing when you were in your 20s, 30s, or even in your 40s. So the first thing that I do now in my 50s that I never thought I would do is I go to tea dances. So my husband Mark and I both love to go ballroom dancing. We started learning to dance about 2.5 years ago, although I did a little bit when I was a youngster, when I was at, you know, school. I think from about 8 to maybe 12 or 13 I did Latin and ballroom dancing. And we went on a cruise about 5 years ago now, and just before the pandemic, and we were watching all the people on the cruise doing sort of ballroom dancing and sequence dancing. And I remember Mark saying to me, I would love to be able to have the courage to get up and do that. So we made a decision that when we came back off the cruise, we would find some dance classes. And then of course we went into lockdown, the whole COVID thing happened, and it took a couple of years before we could do this. But we got into it about 2 years ago and we love it. And we found that the best way to learn is not just having lessons, but actually going out and dancing in a social setting. So we've been on a few different cruises now where we've been able to get up and dance, which has been lovely. But we also go to these tea dances, and in my mind, I have to say, I always assumed they were full of very old people. And the demographic is definitely older. I would say the majority of people that go to the tea dances are in their sort of mid-60s upwards, but we're by no means the youngest. There are definitely couples who are younger than us, and we just have such a lot of fun, and it's a very welcoming community. And the fact that we're not very good doesn't make a difference at all. If we're not sure about a dance, there's always somebody there who's willing to help us. And it's just, we do social dances as well as these tea dances, and we've just found a really lovely community there. I have to be honest, I would never have imagined myself wanting to go and, you know, in the afternoon, go and spend 2 hours doing ballroom and Latin dancing, but it's just so much fun. The second thing that I would never ever have imagined I would be doing in my 50s is starting a YouTube channel. YouTube, you know, has been around, you know, for probably, I don't know how long in all honesty, maybe the last 20 years. And I've always thought of it as a kid's thing, you know, my kids grew up watching YouTube. And it's only in the last couple of years that I've really started to watch YouTube for pleasure. I've used it probably for the last 6-7 years as an educational source for my business, but never really for pleasure. I never would have imagined I would be here doing this, trying to grow a YouTube channel and be a YouTube creator. That just, it seems so bizarre to me, but there seems to be this really sort of growing community of older YouTubers out there. So maybe there's going to be some sort of Gen X boomer revolution here on YouTube, but that's definitely something I never expected I would be doing, but I'm loving it. The third thing is running my own business. I've been employed all of my adult life, never really had any aspirations to have my own business, but I started my business at the age of 52 without any idea how to run a business. And that's been such an incredible change and an incredible experience in my life, and it feels like it's opened so many doors and opportunities. And I've done things in my 50s that I, because of my business, that I never ever would have expected to do, like writing and publishing a book, self-publishing a book, which, if you're interested, if you're still of an age where you might be interested, it's called, that's really bad, isn't it? I can't remember the name of it. It's called, that's shocking. And when I tell you what it's about, it makes even more sense. It's called The Business of Menopause, A Guide for Working Women. And my menopausal brain fog and lack of memory is just classic. Anyway, so I wrote a book called The Business of Menopause, A Guide for Working Women. And I did a TED talk, a TEDx talk. I never thought I'd do that. I never thought I'd get up on stage and talk. And so many things that I've done since I started my business in my 50s that I never expected to do. Broadening my network, meeting amazing people, working with amazing clients, never expected I would be doing that in my 50s. Number four, embracing my own naturale grey hair. Actually, mine's white. It's incredibly white. It's a little bit grey in the back. I don't know if you can see that. I actually started to go grey when I was about 23, 24. And I noticed it first when I was pregnant with my first child, my daughter, Amy. And I could see all these sort of white sprinkles coming through. And my natural hair colour was like an auburny red, more of a sort of chestnutty red, I guess. So quite dark. And I had all of these white hairs coming through. And from, I would say, probably from my early 30s onwards, I've had to dye my hair to get rid of the white. And my roots would grow, especially at the front, would grow in white. So I've had to colour my hair for years. And during COVID, during the pandemic, I couldn't get to my hairdresser. My hair was very long and I was dyeing it myself at home. And I just thought, enough is enough. So when the hairdressers were able to open up again, I got my hairdresser to cut my hair short as it is now. And that meant that I was able to grow out all of the dye. It took me about 6 months because my hair was short by then, and embrace the grey. And I have to say, I'd always said I would dye my hair for as long as I lived, because I couldn't imagine myself ever being grey or white. It just felt like such an old thing, really ageing. And I get so many compliments and so many comments on my hair. And people have said to me, you know, what colour do you put on your hair? It's stunning. Like, I don't, this is it. Even my hairdresser says, you know, I have women coming in much younger than you paying me to colour their hair the colour yours is naturally. I do find sometimes it feels a bit harsh, but it is me, and it is, you know, what it is. And just not having to either spend hours in the hairdresser's chair having it dyed or bothering to do it myself is so much easier. And in actual fact, I don't even wear as much makeup as I used to. I used to wear a lot of makeup, and I don't anymore. I wear a little bit now and again, and I have no qualms about going out without makeup. And so there I am, yeah, no makeup and my silver white hair. And I never thought I would do that, but there you go, I'm embracing it and loving it. Let me know in the comments, have you embraced the grey? And the final one, and I did hover over whether to include this one or not, is one thing I have in my 50s that I never ever thought I would have is my own bedroom. So when the kids moved out and we've got a house with more bedrooms than we need, we actually made the decision to have separate bedrooms. And I think there's a bit of shame wrapped around having separate bedrooms, because I don't know, the thing that always comes to mind is whenever you see crime dramas on television and something's happened and the wife's been killed, and they look and they see that the wife and the husband are sleeping in separate rooms, so automatically their marriage must be in having problems. But it's not like that at all. I'm a night owl, my husband's a lark. In fact, not even just a night owl, quite often I'm still wide awake at sort of 2, 3, 4 in the morning, and I don't want to get up early. And he does. And I'm very untidy. ADHD, I know. I'm very untidy. He's very tidy. It must have driven him nuts having to share a bedroom with me for so many years. Now I have my own space and I can make it as untidy and messy as I want, and it doesn't invade his space, and it has no negative impact on our relationship at all. If anything, I would say it's quite the opposite. I would say it's had a very positive impact, because he gets to sleep a lot better because he's not being kept awake by me, and I get to feel more comfortable in my own space. So in all honesty, it's been brilliant, but it's not something that I ever thought ever that, you know, we would have separate bedrooms, but it has made so, I don't know, it's just made a lot of difference to our quality of sleep and to the quality of our relationship, and I don't think it's talked about enough. I think probably there are an awful lot more couples who do sleep in separate bedrooms than we probably know, because there's still this sort of shame and taboo around it, like there's something fundamentally wrong with your relationship if you don't share a bed and share a bedroom. So there you go. I just thought I would, I don't know why I felt the need to jump on and share these, but it got me thinking. I was thinking about this earlier, about the things that I think differently about now. There's lots of things I could probably add on there in terms of how I think, and you know, the things that I've given up as I've got older, like caring so much about what people think and masking who I am and trying to be something I'm not and trying to fit in when I actually, you know, always felt a bit like I was a square peg in a round hole. So let me know if you found any of this resonated with you, and I'd love you, as I say, in the comments, just let me know what is something that you're doing now in your 50s or your 60s that you never thought you would do, but you've really embraced it. And if you've enjoyed this, I'd love you to give me a thumbs up and perhaps hit the subscribe button if you so wish. And I will talk to you again soon. Take care.